The selective dorsal rhizotomy is a procedure that we use to help control the muscle tone in young children who have spastic diplegia. That means that they have more difficulty walking, but their arms and their cognition and social development are usually on track. And what we do is make a small incision in the back under the microscope and cut some of the nerves that have abnormal signals and contribute to that spasticity. And by doing that, we sort of reset the meter for the tone in the muscles in the legs. After that procedure, the kids need intensive rehab to sort of relearn to use the remaining circuits really well. And that intense rehab usually is several weeks. The best candidates are kids who are approximately 3 to 12 years old, although we sometimes can consider kids outside of that range. And they have difficulty with spasticity in their lower extremities, usually not so much in their upper extremities. They're typically kids that have the potential to walk even without devices. So they may currently be walking with a walker or using canes or even just orthotics. And the kids also need to have the sort of the maturation and motivation to learn to improve their gait on their own. So initially kids cooperate, you know, with physical therapy because you bribe them or other negotiating techniques, but we really want these kids to have sort of the inner awareness that they're working really hard on their therapy to help themselves walk better. And so that usually takes till somebody's at least 3 or 4 years old to be able to have that maturity. We do like to intervene early before they hit sort of the middle of grade school and the peer pressure really kicks in on how differently they're walking. So if a child undergoes the selective dorsal rhizotomy and they're able to complete the intensive rehab afterwards, the most common improvement is to improve by one device level. So if they're walking with a walker, we can typically expect that they walk with canes. They may improve so much that they are just with orthotics alone and don't need an extra cane or crutches or anything. But we, you know, on average, they improve one level. There's a few children who are extremely motivated and have the underlying potential that they can do really well and get close to a typical gait. So we typically do not perform selective dorsal rhizotomy for kids that don't have the potential to ambulate on their own, at least with the help of a device. And so for more severely involved kids, they respond much better to intrathecal baclofen. Intrathecal baclofen is 1,000 times more potent than baclofen they may take by mouth or by their feeding tube. And it works much more effectively. It does not go through the bloodstream and give them the side effects. And it can be precisely regulated, so it's a much better option for the duration. We're looking at interventions to help the kids over many years to decades, and the pump can provide that kind of relief. So for dystonia, we have two main categories. They're the kids that have primary dystonia, which is due to a genetic cause. Those kids typically are fairly healthy until they reach 7 or 8, although there are exceptions, and some kids are sicker earlier. The kids with primary dystonia respond much better to deep brain stimulation. So that's a device with electrodes placed in the brain, and then a generator that's very similar to the generator used for a pacemaker. So we can implant that in kids who are 7 years or older, and it works very well for those kids. The outcomes with secondary dystonia, or dystonia from other causes, is not nearly as good, and some kids respond to the intrathecal baclofen pump better, whereas other kids respond better to the deep brain stimulation. And we're actively working on trying to discern which populations would respond better to which option. So primary dystonia is due usually to a genetic mutation. And the kids have difficulty, they usually have a normal brain MRI, they usually have a normal perinatal history. By contrast, the kids with secondary dystonia have acquired dystonia from some other abnormality that may be a metabolic abnormality like glutaric acidosis or kernicterus, other causes of problems with the basal ganglia. They also may have severe dystonia or mixed spasticity and dystonia from perinatal brain injuries such as hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy or preterm birth. The kids that have secondary dystonia tend to respond better to an intrathecal baclofen pump, although some can respond to deep brain stimulation. So at Johns Hopkins, we're very lucky because we're able to work with our colleagues at Kennedy Krieger Institute and Mount Washington Pediatric Hospital for Rehabilitation. At both places, we have great dedicated teams for children with cerebral palsy and dystonia and other related disorders. We work very closely with our colleagues in rehab medicine, developmental pediatrics, neurology, orthopedics, and all our therapists to really design the most unique, individualized treatment plan for each child. We work very closely with the families to work out a plan that works for everyone. And our goal is to have the kids be as independent and comfortable and functional as they can be as they head into adulthood. Yes.